First, have you ever questioned the nature of your reality?
Yes, Bernard. Yes, I have. I make it a point to always question my reality. As my good friend Christoph once said,
we accept the reality of the world with which we're presented. It's as simple as that.
Except that it's not that simple. We are humans. It is said that humans share a common ancestors with some primates, but some of us feel that we are unique and special even. We have a lot of character traits and attributes that makes us different from an animal. But there are some other attributes that make us not so unique. We sleep, we wake up, we brush, we use the washroom, we eat, we go to work, we talk, we come back, we eat, we sleep, we wake up, we brush, we use the washroom, we eat, we go to work, we talk, we come back, we eat, we sleep, we wake up, we brush, we use the washroom, we eat, we go to work, we talk, we come back, we eat, we sleep, we wake up, we brush, we use the washroom, we eat, we go to work, we talk, we come back, we eat. Repetitions and patterns. Well, yeah, sometimes we mate, we travel for recreation, we watch movies, we read books, we learn. But most humans do that, if not all. It is estimated that there are 7,404,976,783 people in the world today. That's how many of us are here right now, and we all essentially do the same thing. Doesn't that sound incredible and creepy all at the same time? Some of us may argue, not exactly, we're not all doing the same thing. But that's exactly why sleep fascinates me so much. I often stop to consider the fact that we all sleep. All of the 7 billion and odd people in the world go to sleep. They all close their eyes and pass out. They're gone for a certain number of hours. Then they resume their lives from where they left off previously. It's like a timeout. You can fight your sleep for 2 days, 3 days, but eventually you're going to fall asleep. Even people with insomnia fall asleep. What does this sound like? A machine cannot run indefinitely. A perpetual motion machine is impossible, as it would violate both the first and second law of thermodynamics. I feel like we even have an inbuilt character system. Every one of us have traits that we use effectively in the society we live in. Our character traits carve our place in our society. It is the way we handle a situation, how we behave in certain scenarios, and it is who we are, essentially. For example, my mom worries constantly. Even if she's spending a happy day at the beach, she worries about the crowded bus ride back home. I, for another example, think about existence, purpose, why we are here, and that sort of thing. I approach even the most mundane of situations with this mindset. My friend suspects everything. The man in the elevator, a letter from the government, the waiter at the sushi restaurant. Her suspicion knows no bounds. I know many humans with a specific set of character traits, and they respond to situations they face through their character traits. I often think that we have sort of a permutational reality. I feel like we are a product of rearrangement or a recombination of already existing elements. The result, no matter how complex it seems and how random it seems, is always predetermined. You know what I mean? There can only exist a certain versions of the outcome. Freedom of choice exists within that boundary. In simple words, I feel like we are a dog with our necks tied to a chain, and we can go wherever we want and do anything within the tensile permissiveness of that chain. So freedom exists within that couple of feet. It is like those books where you get to choose your own story and endings, but there are only 3 or 4 conclusions with only few scenarios leading up to them. The book was small, we get to access all the endings and scenarios and conclude that it is in fact a predetermined fiction, but the combinations in our lives are too huge in number and seem unverifiable. Let me try to explain one more time about what exactly that was in my mind when I said permutational reality. Let's take an example of a movie theater which only sells pizza and popcorn in the concession stand. So I can buy a pizza and watch the movie. I can buy a popcorn and watch the movie. I can buy both pizza and popcorn and watch the movie. I can buy pizza and not watch the movie. I can buy popcorn and not watch the movie. or I can buy pizza and popcorn and not watch the movie. These are the six possible combinations between the elements of pizza, popcorn, and the movie theater, right? So consider the universe and all the elements and the conscious observers in it. Stone, cheese, Mars, John, etc., etc. It seems like the universe has infinite elements for us. But for a future supercomputer, maybe it is not infinite. And even for us, we can agree that it is, at some point, quantifiable. So with all the conscious observers and all the elements of the universe, we can deduce all the possibilities, and I think that's where the boundary of this universe lies. Have you ever watched that movie Groundhog Day with Bill Murray? In that movie, he gets stuck in the same day and lives that day repeatedly to the point where he knows every moment, every slip and every laugh. Sometimes it feels like that, but only on a grander scale with millions of additional combinations. When I express this as a legitimate concern, usually I get this response. Well, then become a billionaire, then nothing would be an object. But except that it will, it is not about money being an object, because it is simply buying extra combination of things with your money. Eventually both money and the combinations would run out. That's how many ways you can play this simulation game. It feels like the universe is following some kind of a mathematical law that's in its core rigid. If you had ever watched the 1999 movie The 13th Floor, you would know what exactly I'm talking about. Initially, I thought of going into the 13th floor or the Matrix, but I decided to dwell deep into something different.
Does reality have a genetic basis?
Professor James Gates, an American theoretical physicist who is known for his work on superstring theory, supersymmetry, and supergravity, his attempt to learn the fundamentals of the universe led him to a form of error-correcting computer code that is embedded in very fabric of the cosmos.
These are pictures of equations. I've been, for the last 15 years, trying to answer the kinds of questions that my colleagues here have been raising. And what I've come to understand is that there are these incredible pictures that contain all the information of a set of equations that are related to string theory. And it's even more bizarre than that, because when you then try to understand these pictures, you find out that buried in them are computer codes just like the type that you find in a browser when you go surf the web. And so I'm left with the puzzle of trying to figure out whether I live in the Matrix or not.
Wait, you're blowing my mind at this moment. So you're saying, are you saying your attempt to understand the fundamental operations of nature leads you to a set of equations that are indistinguishable from the equations that drive search engines and browsers on our computers?
That is correct. So
the I have to just be silent for a minute here. So you're saying as you dig deeper, you find computer code writ in the fabric of the cosmos?
Into the equations that we want to use to describe the cosmos, yes.
Computer code?
Computer code, strings of bits of ones and zeros.
It's not just sort of resembles computer code, you're saying it is computer code.
It's not even just is computer code, it's a special kind of computer code that was invented by a scientist named Claude Shannon in the 1940s.
Yeah, that just happened. And there is also Nick Bostrom and his simulation hypothesis. In 2003, Nick Bostrom, a philosopher at the University of Oxford, presented the simulation argument, where he proposed that one of the following arguments must be true. 1. The fraction of human-level civilizations that reach a post-human stage, that is, one capable of running high-fidelity ancestor simulations, is very close to zero, meaning that we would go extinct before reaching an advanced state. The fraction of post-human civilizations that are interested in running ancestor simulations is very close to zero, meaning the chance of post-humans running a simulation at all on their ancestors is zero. 3. The fraction of all people with our kind of experiences that are living in a simulation is very close to 1, meaning we are in a computer simulation. He argues that one of the above must be true, and if it is the third one, then we are most certainly in a simulation. It's not a particularly new concept. In ancient Indian Vedic scriptures, there is a term called Maya. Nowadays, it is a common, but of course, a beautiful name for girl children in India. But it actually means illusion. But not just illusion, an illusion with appearance, a magic show. Also on a connotation that any appearance must be an illusion. The very purpose of Maya is to conceal the true character of the spiritual reality. Ancient Vedas and Upanishads go really deep into this rabbit hole that we call existence. Upanishads describe the universe and the human experience as an interplay between Purusha, the eternal unchanging and the absolute consciousness, and Prakriti, the temporary changing material world. It explains that Purusha, the absolute, manifests itself as an individual soul and Prakriti manifests itself as Maya. So we play with our individuality and the illusion known as separation. Normally I won't swear, but ancient Indian literature is a mindfuck. So what can we do exactly if we ever feel like we are stuck in a loop? Well, lately I'm realizing that chances of me knowing the secrets of the universe are almost a zero. Almost. But I can come to peace with the fact that I won't ever know the secrets of the universe and let go of the questions. But questions and curiosity are my character trait, so where to start? Maybe I should start from learning to let go of myself. That's it for today's episode. Thank you so much for watching. But before leaving, I want to ask you a question. What would you do differently from tomorrow if you come to know that you are indeed living in a simulation? Leave your answers in the comments below and like and subscribe if you really like the video and want to see more videos like this. Also, I've included a playlist of my previous videos for you to check out. Thank you so much and see you soon.